Well, hello and welcome to this week's edition of the City Update. I'm your host, Mark Aaron, Multimedia Design Manager for the City of Danville. My guest this week, our Director of Public Works, Rick Drazenovich. Of course, we'd like to have Rick on at least three or four times a year to talk about the happenings within Public Works, and especially during this time of year because it's loose leaf collection season here in the City of Danville. It starts on October 1st, runs through January 31st. So Rick's crews are out and about and even more visible than ever during this time of year. And then we're also going to get into snow removal as well as we head into the winter months. But on today's show, we'll talk about rules and regulations for loose leaf collection to make everything go smooth, not only on your end as a citizen here in the City of Danville, but for Rick's crews as well. And then also, we're going to Rick has really compiled a list of 10 things that Public Works wants you to know. They get a lot of calls here with covering a lot of different topics.
That's right.
And so Rick has done a great job compiling a list of 10 things he wants the citizens of Danville to know. He's going to answer a lot of those questions on today's show. But Rick, I appreciate you taking the time to join us today and talking a little bit about loose leaf collection. And I know you kind of stagger your crews out throughout this collection process. So tell me a little bit about where we are as we head into really November for loose leaf collection.
Well, of course, the loose leaf collection starts October 1st, and generally it doesn't fall in October until usually mid-November is when we get the heavy leaf fall. Yeah. And then we scale up our response and put more crews into it as needed. But from October 1st to January 1st, you can rake the leaves to the front of your property, and the vacuums will come by and pick them up. We do request that it be piled in the front of the property so the vacuum can stop in one place and pick up that pile. Right. A lot of residents would like to just blow them out to the property line and along the whole length of the property line leave a windrow that runs the length of it. And the problem with that is we don't have enough crews to collect windrows in front of every house.
Yeah.
Could be, you know, 100 miles of windrows in the heavy part of the season. So it's got to be in a pile, not a windrow.
Okay.
And you can bag your leaves during this time, but don't be surprised if they simply cut the bag and empty it into the hopper or vacuum it up.
Yeah.
Because, you know, when we're geared up to collecting loose leaves, it's harder to collect bagged leaves with that. They have to be debagged.
And you talk about we have biodegradable bags that they can buy here at Public Works, right?
That's correct. The one exception to that is you can get free biodegradable paper bags at Public Works. We give 15 out per resident per week. And those we simply throw into the truck, and they are ground up with the rest of the leaves and given back as mulch.
Okay.
You can place your vacuumed piles out anytime. They are picked up on the regular collection day as much as possible. And it depends on heavier falls. We may get behind, but we always try and start the beginning of the week on Monday on Monday's route.
Okay.
So we'll work overtime as much as is necessary to try and get back on schedule by Monday.
Okay.
There's a lot of do's and don'ts with loose leaf pickup because it could either damage the equipment or make it difficult for us to be able to get access to the pile. So it sounds like a lot of requirements, but it's mostly common sense.
Okay.
In your pile, don't put any brush, rocks, sticks, bottles, or any solid objects, because it damages the equipment, and it could injure the operator if it's glass or something to that effect. Don't pile them below grade. The leaf vacuum hoses can reach about 4 feet from the side of the vacuum. If it's beyond that, it's got to be raked closer.
Mm-hmm.
And the crews don't have the time during leaf season to rake them closer. So you've got to put them close enough for us to reach and not down in a ditch, because the further that they're down in a ditch, the shorter our reach is, and we can't get them out of a ditch.
And you talk about kind of your yard waste, because I know a lot of people go during this time of year picking up their sticks and loose limbs that have fallen in the yard during the fall season. So I know yard waste crews are still out during this time of year, so you need to take those loose limbs and things of that nature and just place them in a separate pile. They'll be picked up same day, right?
They'll be picked up the same day as long as the volume that's out there allows it.
Right.
We have several different kind of vacuums, and one is pulled by a dump truck with a vacuum behind it. And in those case, we can throw the leaves up in the back of the dump truck, I mean the the branches up in the back of the dump truck.
Yeah.
And the other ones are the green regular rear loaders, and we still can pick up the branches with them.
Okay.
So yeah, we'll pick up branches, but if they're mixed in with the leaves, then we have to try and vacuum around the branches and then pick the branches up, and it makes it extremely difficult on the operator.
Right. And I know another thing is your stormwater drains, and a lot of people will rake their leaves to the curb and block those drains, right?
Well, each property has a unique front to it.
Yeah.
Some of them have stormwater ditches, some of them have curbs and gutters, some have medians between the sidewalk and the curb.
Yeah.
Each one is a unique situation. You just have to find the best location to put it.
Right.
You shouldn't rake it close to a fire hydrant. Don't put it on top of a water meter box.
Mm-hmm.
The vacuums will suck the lid off the meter box and through the vacuum hose.
Wow.
You know, okay. Especially the lighter plastic lids.
Yeah.
And that creates a problem then with us having to replace that lid and could damage the equipment.
Okay.
So putting it close to fire hydrants or close to vehicles. If you have vehicles parked on the street and you rake your leaves to the front of the vehicle, the hose on the side of the vacuum cannot reach very close to the vehicle.
Yeah.
And the combination of trailer and truck can't turn very sharply.
Yeah.
So if it's at a vehicle, the operator is going to stay well clear of the vehicle because he doesn't want to damage somebody's car.
Sure.
And then your leaves don't get picked up.
And I guess the best way to handle that situation is if you have raked your leaves to the curb for that particular day's pickup, be smart maybe just to park your car in your driveway or just not on the street near that pile of leaves, right?
Yeah, and I'd like to say that we could notify everybody every time we leave a pile, but there's just not that much time with the number of crews we have to do that. So
yeah.
When they come to a pile and somebody has parked their vehicle on top of the pile or right next to the pile, we skip it and keep going, and we'll get it next week.
And I think the citizens of Danville would kind of need to realize that how fortunate are that we still have loose leaf pickup here in the city of Danville, because a lot of municipalities have really gone away from that service.
That's correct. It's a service that we can still afford within the $16.50.
Yeah.
And our goal is to keep it on schedule with the garbage collection as much as possible, and we do that most years.
Yeah.
It depends on what the leaves fall like. Each year is like each property front is unique. Each year is unique.
Yeah.
This year, very, very wet year, which keeps people from raking, so it allows us to stay on schedule with fewer crews.
Right.
So it's been an inexpensive year so far.
So how many crews do you actually have out on a particular day on a route?
Well, we have the capability of putting out 13 vacuums and then one, what we call a dead end truck. It's a vacuum on a chassis that is able to turn around where there's no cul-de-sac.
Right.
So we can put out 14 trucks.
Hmm.
And if need be, we can put out our garbage trucks, our rear loaders, to pick up the bagged material that's out there, which helps us stay on schedule.
Okay.
What happens is we have four regular four regular yard waste trucks.
Okay.
And when it gets heavier, we break those four into each one into two routes, and then we have eight trucks out there. And if it gets heavier yet, we break them into three routes, and we have 12 out there.
Mm.
So we gear up to meet the demand.
And I know with 14 different trucks out there during prime fall season, I guess, it really is a great opportunity for Public Works to come together, because you got a lot of great guys out there that coming off some other projects
That's
to help
right.
get this done, right?
It's a tough time of the year on the collectors.
Yeah.
It's a lot of work to spend 8 or 10 hours just vacuuming leaves, but they do an excellent job. And one of the things I'd like to remind the residents of is don't approach the vacuum.
Right.
End of the equipment to talk to the operator. First of all, he can't really hear you.
Mm-hmm.
Second of all, it is very hazardous. Those vacuums will pick up rocks and bricks, and so they'll pull you under into the vacuum, not through the vacuum, but you can get injured by approaching that equipment.
I never thought about that, but I guess you probably do have residents wanting to come up and ask questions to all your operators. I didn't think about that.
Yeah, if you're going to approach the vehicle at all, you need to approach the driver.
Mm-hmm.
as with all heavy equipment, there's a risk if you don't know how it operates, there's a risk of injury.
Very good. Well, now, so loose leaf collection season obviously runs until January 31st. And again, if you have any questions you'd like to ask Rick or his staff, you can always call Public Works. Of course, the number there on the screen, it'll be up throughout today's show, and we talk about a number of different projects. But Rick, any other thing dealing with loose leaf collection we want to get out to the citizens on today's show? I think we covered about every situation that, that can occur.
I think we covered most things. A couple of points is that we collect from the residential units that pay the residential solid waste fee.
Right.
So if someone would like to rake a empty lot off that's not paying the fee, they'll have to dispose of that material themselves.
Okay.
So, you know, we get this time of the year, we get a lot of lot clearing, and that is the responsibility of the lot owner, not the city, to collect that material.
Okay. Very good. Well, as we talk about the fall season here in the city of Danville, that's actually going to be winding down here soon. We'll be heading into the winter months. And I know, Rick, you've had all your crews out getting prepared for you call it a snow day here in this, at Public Works, when you have all your staff out going through the ropes of what to do.
Day. Yeah. Yep.
What to do in case of a snowstorm here in the city of Danville. We always do a great job here in the city, Rick's crews do, handling snow removal here in the city of Danville. And we kind of have a secret sauce there with the brine that Rick has been using over the last few years to help remove that on the main thoroughfares here in the city of Danville. But Rick, as I mentioned, you had your snow day. Are we prepared for any snowstorms this year?
We are. We have an adequate supply of abrasives, of sand, to apply to the street. Our salt sheds are full. This time of the year, we spend some time with the motor pool, going over the equipment, making sure everything's operable and in order, and putting it back under the shed. And we have a snow training day, which all of the crews who respond to emergency snow response get together, talk about the last year, how it went, determine if we have new procedures or new streets, or we have novice drivers out there, they get to drive the plows.
Yeah.
It's a day-long practice and training session. It's really interesting.
And I know it's some long days for your staff, because it seems like a majority of your staff is on call during those snowstorms to get those streets cleared as quickly as possible here in the city of Danville. But great to hear we're ready.
The whole department goes on emergency response call, and we break it into two 12-hour shifts, and we work around the clock. And it's not just the streets. It's shoveling all of the city sidewalks. It's shoveling all of the and pushing all the parking lots. It's the motor pool who has to keep all this equipment going, and the dispatchers and the clerks that need to be responding to the office calls. So it's a full department involvement.
Yeah, good point. Not only the plows on the road, but a lot of work behind the scenes to make everything go smooth. So
it does.
Glad to know we're ready. And I know it was kind of a light winter last year. So have you read the Farmer's Almanac? Or are we looking in for a harsh winter this year, Rick?
Yeah, I think they're predicting. They don't classify it as harsh or not. It's dry or wet, and then cold or warm. And, you know, if you get a warm dry combination, or a warm wet combination, or even a cold dry combination, you're all right.
Yeah,
it's when you get wet and cold, and that is what they're predicting. Is we've had a lot of rain leading into it. We've had some rainstorms that have some fronts that come through, and it's rained for 8 straight days, which is extremely unusual for this area.
Right.
And so if that pattern continues, which they're projecting at least for the next month.
Yeah.
And if we get some colder than usual temperatures, we could have long snow events.
Wow. And how do we go about the maintenance firms from VDOT? Do they fund the projects for snow removal here in the city of Danville? How does that work?
Yeah, we get a certain amount of funds, maintenance funds, from VDOT per lane mile.
Right.
And we have almost 600 lane miles.
Yeah.
And that comes into us as a lump sum of money. And we use it for traffic signals, resurfacing, all of the things that are related to streets, whether it's drainage, curb gutter, sidewalk, and then there's operational issues like snow plowing and pothole filling and sweeping and landscaping. And so all of that
removal falls under that umbrella.
And there's a budget we present every year that allocates those VDOT funds to what we feel are the most critical needs.
Gotcha. Very good. Well, Rick, we're going to take a quick break, but when we come back from break, as I mentioned in my intro, you've got compiled a list of 10 things you'd like for the citizens to know when it comes to dealings within public works. I know you get hundreds of calls down here.
We do.
On a daily basis, dealing with a lot of different topics, but not only with loose leaf snow removal, but when you talk about refuse collection, a lot of different things. So when we come back from break, we're going to talk a little bit about that list of top things that Rick, who's Director of Public Works here in the city of Danville, would like for you, the citizens of Danville, to know. So you don't want to miss out on that. And again, loose leaf collection running through the city of Danville until January 31st. If you have any questions about any of the things we touched on earlier in the show when it comes to loose leaf collection, feel free to give Public Works a call. So stay tuned. We'll be right back.
Everywhere that we go, he makes people laugh and makes people smile, and I feel like I have that quality.
He's the one who always takes me fishing.
I watch golf with him. And
I watch him cook, because when I grow up, I want to be a cook too.
We have the same faces like this.
Dad is the one, when you fall, that picks you up.
That unconditional sense of presence and reassurance is really what makes him my father.
Well, welcome back to this week's edition of the City Update. I'm your host, Mark Aaron, Multimedia Design Manager for the City of Danville. My guest this week, Rick Drazenovich, our Director of Public Works. In the first half of the show, we were talking loose leaf collection. Of course, runs from October 1st until January 31st here in the City of Danville. And Rick's crews are out and about in full force now, collecting the loose leaves here in the city of Danville. And we touched on a lot of different topics when it comes to loose leaf collection, making everything go smooth here in the city of Danville. And in the second half of the show, Rick actually went around to all his different division directors here within Public Works and asked them some of the top 10 things that they would like the citizens to know about their different divisions. And Rick has done a great job compiling, I guess, an overall top 10 for the department. And we're going to touch on each one of those on today's show because as we touched on in the first half of the show, they get a lot of calls out here at Public Works pertaining to a lot of different topics. But, Rick, I appreciate you taking the time to do that because I know there's a lot of things we could cover on the show. We only have 30 minutes, so I guess I'm going to turn it over to you, and we'll just kind of go down the list of the top 10 things you'd like for our citizens to know. And number one is dealing with, I guess, an automated collection system.
Right, right. Actually, after the response, I got the top 100 things.
Yeah.
It was difficult boiling it down
yeah.
and reducing it to the top 10. So we may have to do this again.
Very good.
But these are the top 10 items that we get a lot of calls on, and it may not be clear to the residents on some of these items what they should be doing or not.
Right.
And we cover so many things like traffic signals and sidewalks and holes and potholes and complaints and even the cleanup fix-up month. There's a lot of items that we need to discuss with the residents, and if we just went down the list and talked about it, it almost seemed like it's an endless number of restrictions and requests.
Right.
And but that's the way these systems have to be run. They have to be uniform and safe for the drivers, the operators, and the public.
Mm-hmm.
I think the top item that we'd like the residents to know is that now that we have the automated system, it's saving the city a lot of money. We've reduced our workforce significantly,
yeah.
and it allows us to keep the $16.50 rate. We haven't raised the rate since 2005.
Yeah.
But along with that, the residents have to do their part. And the biggest thing we want them to know is that anything that fits in an automated container should be put in an automated container. They should not differentiate between small bulk debris and household garbage. The containers are not only for household garbage. If you have books or you're cleaning out your basement or you're throwing away old vases or toasters or whatever junk or debris, mm-hmm. lampshades, whatever that may be, put it in the container.
Okay.
And if you don't have container space, then you may be in need of a second container.
Do you all still offer the containers for sale here at Public Works?
We do. 35-gallon containers, which are very small and appropriate for a one- or two-person household mm-hmm. that doesn't throw away a lot of other debris. We have a 64-gallon container, appropriate for a household that may throw debris away along with their household garbage. The 96-gallon container fits most things. You got old potted plants, whatever you have, go in there.
Okay.
And we don't limit the number of containers you have, within reason, you can have two 96-gallon containers if you have a large family and you generate a lot of other items that you throw away. But you can't stack it on top of the container, okay, or put it beside the container. The driver then has to get out and throw it very high up into the hopper in the truck. These trucks are made to collect automated containers.
Okay. Now, what if I have like an old microwave or a VCR or even a refrigerator? How do we go about disposing of those?
If it's a VCR and it fits in the can, put it in the cart. Can.
Okay.
If it's a microwave and it don't fit in the cart, put it beside the cart. We still do pick up bulk debris, but the qualification on the bulk debris is that it's too large to fit in the cart. Okay. So if you have a lawn chair and you can't get in the cart, it put it beside there. Or if you have an end table or a microwaver, and we pick up bulk debris on the same day as we pick up the carts.
Okay.
When the automated side loading truck comes by, he's got a iPad with him. He punches it in, and that notifies the bulk debris truck that there's bulk debris at that address. He gets it automatically and blends it in with his route, and he'll come by and get it the same day.
Okay, so very good.
We're very automated with that.
So no need to call Public Works if I have a refrigerator that needs to be picked up.
Should not. It should not. And it doesn't mean we don't miss some bulk debris, sure, or right, there's a miscommunication or something. But generally, they'll come by and pick it up, and it's a very good service.
Very good. All right. So again, if you have one container and you can't fit all your refuse in that one container, you can come down to Public Works, pick one. It's great price too.
Yeah,
a lot cheaper than what you can get in your big box.
It's $50 for the 96-gallon, and I think it's $45 for the 64-gallon, and $35 for the smaller one.
Okay.
We don't recommend the small 35-gallon. It's just too small, except for a individual who generates only a very little bit of waste. Right.
And again, you need to bring that can to the curb. I know last week I forgot to bring mine out, and the wife wasn't too happy about that, but they don't come. I mean, some people may still think they come to the back of the house to pick the can up. With the automated system, you have to bring the can.
The automated system is meant to avoid workers' comp claims.
Yeah.
It's meant for the driver to stay in the truck. It takes them only a few seconds to dump a cart and move on to the next one, and it has reduced our staffing significantly by 80%.
That's great. All right, so now let's, I guess that was number one on the list, was about number two, right?
We're going to jump around, and we may come back to refuse collection again, because that may be number five or six again.
Okay.
Number two is snow plowing. Mm-hmm. You know, the public works has many seasons. We've got the loose leaf season, and then we've got the winter snow season. We've got the cleanup fix-up month, and then we get into weed abatements and code enforcement in the summertime. And so it's we move through the seasons responding to different tasks.
Sure.
When we're plowing snow, the plows have no choice but to drop the snow off the edge of the blade on the right-hand side. Mm-hmm. And that means that if you've shoveled your driveway or you've shoveled a parking place out, when the plow comes through there, they're going to fill that back in with a windrow of snow.
Yeah.
There's no way to avoid it. And it's an unfortunate circumstance of living in winter weather. And we're right on the border of having a lot of snows, so we're not used to shoveling as much as maybe some of the northern tiers are.
Right.
You may not have neighborhood youths who come around and offer to shovel your snow for you. You know, up north, that's practically a business for the teens, is to make some money shoveling.
Yeah.
It just has to be shoveled out. The city does not have adequate equipment to go back and plow out the maybe 30,000 driveways we have. We have 16, almost 17,000 residential units. I think when you add in the commercial properties, it gets up close to 28 or 29,000, and many of them have multiple driveways. So there's no realistic way that we can send trucks back, and there's no alternative that keeps the snow from going off the side of the blade.
Right.
So we just don't have the manpower. We don't have the money to do it, actually.
Okay.
And it's, you know, when people call in and say, "You filled in my driveway," we apologize, but there's nothing we can do about it.
Try to time it right after the plow goes by if you can. I know that's not always possible, but
that's correct.
That's the best way to do it.
You know, and it may occur on situations where you have to shovel your driveway because you need to get in and out. You don't want to pack the snow down in the driveway. And then when you get home from work, you need to shovel out that windrow again. We don't recommend trying to run into the windrow to get over it. If it's been plowed there early in the evening and it's been a cold night.
Got to damage a vehicle.
Yeah, you're going to damage a bumper if you hit a packed snowbank that looks soft, but it's not soft.
Very good point. Okay, so now number three.
Well, number three is that is another snow issue. Okay. City code requires that the property adjacent to public sidewalks shovel the public sidewalk within 24 hours after the snow falls. Not enforced a lot, but it is a requirement that we'd like the residents to understand that it's their responsibility to shovel their sidewalk off. And, you know, if you have a lot of foot traffic on your sidewalk, it would be the courteous thing to do.
Right.
Businesses generally take care of that. But,
yeah.
And if you own a property that's not occupied, you're still obligated to shovel that sidewalk off. Mm. Just because there's no business there doesn't mean that you should leave the traveling public walk on an icy sidewalk.
So does that, one thing that comes to mind, I guess if I live on Westover Drive where there's a sidewalk, I'm responsible for
that
sidewalk on my property.
That's correct. Okay. And many people either don't know that or choose to ignore it.
Yeah.
But the sidewalk is your responsibility to shovel by code in 24 hours.
All right. Now, number four is dealing with sewer maintenance. And I know when I first started with the city, it'd been 10 years ago, I went out with Donnie and his crews.
Right.
And it took me a while to understand this next thing you're going to discuss. And so I can understand why the public has a hard time grasping the service laterals and who's responsible when these laterals get clogged. So, but now that I have a good grasp and I explain it to a lot of people because it happens more often than
absolutely.
You would think. So tell me a little bit about sewer maintenance, what Public Works is responsible for on the main line, and then the service lateral, of course, is the responsibility of the homeowner.
Well, let's start from an empty lot.
Yeah.
When you build your house on an empty lot or when it is built by a subdivider, we have sanitary sewers that are in the main line, in the center line of the street generally. Some in other locations, but a typical application would be the center line. The city installs and is responsible for keeping that main line and owns that main line sanitary sewer in the center line of the road. If you build a house and you'd like to connect to that, you purchase the tap from your house to out all the way out to the main line, and that becomes the homeowner's sewer tap. Even under the street, it belongs to the homeowner and is the homeowner's responsibility for maintaining it, keeping it open, and cleaning it periodically, not the city's.
And I guess the main issue arises is when
that
lateral goes under the street.
It
goes to the main line that may be a little ways up the road a little bit, and ties into it right in the center of the street. So they're wondering, why do I have to service something that's in
the and that is the complexity of it.
Yeah.
It is not yours only on your property, but the connection all the way to the main line is yours. Right. And you, if in the case of getting a new one put in, you have to pay for that tap to be put in. And the city puts it in the right of way for obvious reasons. We want to make sure the compaction is done well and the patch is done properly and it's done with proper traffic control.
Mm-hmm.
But it is still a sewer connection that you pay for and becomes the homeowner's property and responsibility to maintain it.
And when you all come out, you will flush the main line.
If it feels
like there's a backup, because I know a lot of people have their plumber come over and say, well, it's not in the lateral, it's in the main line. You all will come flush the main line if there is an issue, but then anything in that lateral is homeowner's responsibility.
That's correct. Yeah. Often we get a call about backup in the building,
mm-hmm.
and we come out and we can flush the main line, we can televise it, we can ensure that it's flowing properly, and then we turn the issue back over to the homeowner and explain to them that their sewer connection to the main line has a blockage and they have to get a plumber.
That's great information. I'm glad we brought that back up because it's been a while since we visited that. But I know just talking to Donnie and the sewer maintenance crews quite a bit, that's still an issue. I guess it always will be until people really get a
Well, a lot of these things are inconvenient issues.
Yeah.
And the homeowners who call us are are upset because we didn't pick up something outside the can, or we're telling them that the sewer tap by code belongs to them, even all the way out to the main line, or they have to shovel their sidewalk and it's a city sidewalk.
It's just things they don't want to hear, but it's part of the
in community living, the property owners have a certain responsibility to do some things,
right.
and a certain amount of responsibility goes on to the city, onto public works to do.
Sure.
Repairs to sidewalks, repairs to curb and gutter, repairs to the main line, repairs to the road.
Right.
But there are certain things that fall on the property owner.
Okay, very good. Now let's head on. We're down the list, number five, and we're going back to refuse collection.
back to refuse collection, and I can't stress enough how much we are saving by this automated collection, mm-hmm. and it puts some responsibilities on the homeowner. And I know it's not popular to be out of the backyard and you didn't ever have to worry about your refuse, but in today's automated society, it isn't that simple anymore that it just gets done for you.
Right.
When you place your cart out, the cart cannot be placed right near a car. We have occasions where the front bumper is touching the cart.
We've got an image now. We're showing the viewers examples of some of those.
Right, and this is probably the most extreme.
Yeah.
But it is not safe for the driver to reach out and pick up that cart, which means he's got to get out and move it. Mm-hmm. And our objective is not to have the driver getting out of the cab. And we can even reduce our manpower further if we don't have to get out for those events.
Right.
So don't put it near a pole, or near a guy wire, or near your mailbox, or right on top of your leaf pile. All of those create problems for the driver to be able to dump it.
Hmm.
And at some point, we will start enforcing that and leaving the cart behind and not dumping it.
Yeah.
The other thing is that there needs to be a clear space between the carts of a foot or two, enough that the grabber can reach between the carts and pick them up and put them back down without damaging the next cart. So they shouldn't be touching and right close together, and they should be a little space.
All right. So your first five have been great, Rick. So I'm looking forward to hearing what you have for your final five here.
I have a top 100.
Yeah.
So
number six.
Well, number six, public works is when we do snow. So you didn't know it was snow.
So, yeah, I didn't know. We're going back and forth, right?
That's right. It was flipped under the page and you couldn't see it. We're back to snow.
Okay.
And this is in the order of the importance that we place on it. So it'll flip back and forth.
Yeah.
We constantly stress what our schedule is on snow removal.
Right.
When we get notice of a storm, we send half of our crews home, we brine the streets, we get all prepared, and the crews go on 12-hour shifts, and when the storm hits, we start 7-to-7 shifts in 5 zones, and we have 23 plows out there. We're very prepared for a snowstorm,
mm-hmm.
unless it hits and we in a surprise change in the weather.
Yeah.
We concentrate on the primaries. Plowing the residentials is of no value if the primaries aren't open.
Right.
During the snowfall, the actual snowstorm when it's falling, we only have enough trucks to keep the primaries open,
right.
and that. If people need to get out or in an emergency, if they can make it to a primary, they can generally make it to their destination.
Mm-hmm.
And we do that full-time, round the clock, during the snowstorm. At the end of the snowstorm, when it's clear that the snow has ended, we make one last pass over the primaries and arterials to kick back the edges to make sure that it is actually snow-free,
right.
as close to the pavement as we can get. And then we move on. It takes us 2 to 4 hours to do that after the snow stops.
Hmm.
Then we move on to the collectors. Those are the feeder roads that go into the subdivision. Again, it's logical. If you can't get onto the feeder roads and out of your subdivision,
right.
then you know, there's no point in doing the residentials. It takes us about 4 hours to get the subdivision collectors open. And we do it in that order. And then after that 4 hours, we move on to the residentials. And the plows are divided into zones, so nobody gets all of the plows.
Mm-hmm.
Each zone is responsible for their own They have 4 or 5 plows in the zone, and they're responsible for the residential units, the residential streets.
And I know you all have a goal as a department to clear all roads by, what's the timetable from when the snow stops, right?
From when the snow stops, yeah. 24 to 36 hours.
Okay.
And I think in a rare occasion when it's very, very heavy and we're pushing full plows of snow and it's very cold, it may take us 48 hours.
Mm-hmm.
But generally, it's 24 to 36 hours, especially if it pushes easy.
Very good.
And when we push overnight, you may have an occasion where we pushed your residential street. It don't even hardly look pushed because it froze down to the street. But we can't stop pushing on those events. We sand the streets and push them the best we can during
good.
The night.
Very good. All right, so number 7, I think we're going back to, what is it, yard waste collection now?
Yard waste Change? Collection, yeah. You see a theme here. Maybe the snow and the solid waste are important. Our big three are snow, solid waste, and sanitary sewers, I think. The city is not a tree removal service.
Okay.
We're not staffed to cut down or remove trees that have been cut down. We don't have enough manpower. We don't have enough trailers.
Mm-hmm.
We don't have the time to get around. We have 4 yard waste collection crews under typical circumstances.
Okay.
So if as a homeowner you take a tree down, or if you have a contractor take a tree down, part of that removal is disposal of the tree.
Okay.
You know, we recommend that if there's tree trunks that are worth firewood, you can almost always give firewood away.
Yeah.
But then the branches and the remainder of that needs to be either chipped by a contractor or taken to our compost site yourself.
Okay.
We do have trailers, 20 cubic yard trailers, that we rent for $75 for yard waste and $120 for debris that you can call down here. We'll park it at your location. You can fill it with the brush and we'll take it away.
And I know you can set brush out, but it has to be, what's the dimensions of the pile?
You can set, it's really clippings and yard waste. It isn't meant to be whole tree removal.
Right.
And that's
okay.
where folks, they figure
they're lining their whole front property with branches.
Yeah, someone might think, I don't put out branches all the rest of the year. So, if I put out an occasional big pile, it all equals out.
Mm.
But we don't have the trucks to pick up big piles. During the cutting season, a lot of people would like to put out huge piles.
Sure.
Four cubic yards, which is about a level pickup truck load full, the size of an average sofa or kitchen table, if you need a size reference.
Okay.
No more than 4 feet long, and we'll get that. Mm-hmm. But we can't pick up whole trees, especially if you use a contractor. They should chip it and get rid of it.
Gotcha.
But even if you have, your friends come by and have a tree removal party.
Yeah.
You still can't put out that very large pile. We're not geared for that.
Okay. Very good. Well, we're in the home stretch now, so we've got
number eight.
Yeah.
Okay. This is a pretty simple one, and it's not sanitary sewers, it's not yard waste, and it's not refuse collection or snow.
Mm-hmm.
And it's
the suspense is killing me, Rick.
It's a legal thing, yeah. I know it is. Don't dump or pour or place anything in the storm sewers that is not stormwater.
Okay.
Don't wash your car and flush
That's
it down the storm sewer.
Wash, yeah.
Don't dump your grease in the storm sewer thinking it'll be okay and it'll biodegrade. Don't put pesticides down there. Don't dump whatever it is that you dump. It should not go in there. It goes directly into the drinking water and affects the cleanliness and clarity of the river.
Okay.
And it's illegal.
Mm-hmm.
Besides that, you're not supposed to do that. If you're going to wash your car, find a grassy area. Don't wash it in the driveway and let it run down into the storm sewers.
Right.
And there's a big push by EPA and the federal government to stop that.
And I know we're regulated by the federal government on that because I know we air PSA public service announcements here on River City TV dealing with that because it's a requirement.
We have a lot of requirements from EPA.
Sure.
They permit our stormwater systems, which is called a non-point source because it's from generally the whole area.
Mm-hmm.
And we have permits that we have to and target goals that we have to meet.
All right. So your last two, I know they've got to deal with one of them's got to deal with refuse collection, by the way.
Yeah, it is.
Okay.
Yeah, it is. and the last one deals with everything.
Okay.
The side-loading garbage trucks have an arm that come out and reach out and grab the container. Residents who have the issue, which was number one, about placing things in the cart, often think that it's the inconvenience of the driver getting out that's the only reason we don't pick up what's out of the cart. Well, the many of them reason that if they go and throw it into the truck themselves, that that'll solve the problem. So they have an extra bag of garbage, and they wait to time the garbage truck coming by, and they come out and try and throw it in the garbage truck.
Wow.
Do not do that.
Yeah.
If that driver don't see you approaching the garbage truck from the rear or from the side and is reaching out, you get injured by that. That is a very dangerous action to do, is to approach the garbage truck and try and throw trash into it.
Yeah.
So, in fact, any of our construction vehicles, whether they're cleaning sewers, sweeping streets, particularly those that reach out the side for garbage cans,
right,
should not be approached either by children or adults or anyone.
The
driver don't know you're there sometimes. And being safe around all construction and operating equipment.
Sure.
But more particularly, we found people trying to throw bags of refuse up into the truck.
I never thought that, yeah.
You'd be surprised.
Yeah, and number 10, we're going to wrap it all up with...
Number 10.
Call us about anything, right?
That's basically what we're saying. Yeah. Is Public Works gets 12,000 to 15,000 calls a year.
That's
and
amazing.
That may not even be all of them. The ones that are solved easy probably don't get recorded.
Sure.
You know? But if you have problems with litter or potholes or dead animals or illegal dumping or suspicious activity where they might be stealing manhole covers or red lights that don't operate or stop signs down or places that haven't been mowed, call us. The number's up on the screen, and we will respond. If there's a hole out there in the street that someone has, and recently we had Halloween, and you know, and the Halloweeners out there and had stepped into a hole, and we get a call the next day. But we need to know about the hazardous and the items that are of concern before we can do anything on it. We'll go out, we'll put a cone on it, we'll figure out what it is, and we'll solve the problem. And that goes for all of the things, all of the items Public Works is responsible for.
Yeah.
Don't be afraid to call. It's not a problem. We want to hear if a bag of litter fell off on a street somewhere. We have litter crews that go pick it up. If a tree limb's fallen down, or there's a hole somewhere, or something's washed out.
Yeah.
You know, to the extent we can do something about it, we will do it almost immediately.
Yeah, and I always say every time we have Rick on, their department does a great job with customer service and answering the questions that they receive in a timely fashion. So again, as Rick mentioned, if there's anything out there that you have a question about that Public Works can take care of, go ahead and give them a call. We've had the number up there throughout the show, so 799-5245, and they'll be glad to help you. And if you ask for Rick and he's in, you're going to talk to Rick.
that's exactly right. Great. We'll do all we can, and often the answer that someone gets may not be the answer they want,
right.
But we will investigate and respond to complaints.
Right. Well, Rick, I appreciate you taking the time to join us today. A lot of great information. I hope the citizens at home were taking notes, and I love the top 10 list there. We'll have to have you back on sooner rather than later. We'll do a show of just the top 50. Yeah, because you got 90 more left, you're right?
I do.
It has been compiled. Yeah.
It does change.
Yeah, I'm sure. Well, Rick, thanks again for joining us. We appreciate it.
Thank you.
And thank you at home for watching. Until next week, have a great day.